This is Module 4 of the North Carolina Department of Transportation Erosion and Sediment Control Certification Training covering regulatory requirements. The instructor is Rich McLaughlin, professor in the Department of Crop and Soil Sciences at North Carolina State University. The goal of the NCDOT certification program is to help ensure the protection of jurisdictional areas of the state. This includes all waters of the state and their buffers and shorelines. It also includes protecting endangered species and historic properties. There are four primary agencies which are involved in protecting these resources, not including the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. Within the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality, there are three divisions with different areas of jurisdiction: energy, mineral, and land resources, water resources, and coastal management. In addition, the U.S. Corps of Engineers, often just referred to as the Corps, has federal jurisdiction over all surface waters. We'll discuss each of these agencies' interests as they relate to construction of highway in just a minute. In most states, the Clean Water Act of 1972 directed them to establish a law protecting surface waters from sediment. In North Carolina, this was the Sedimentation Pollution Control Act of 1973. It gave authority to the Department of Environmental Quality to enforce the five mandatory acts or standards of the act. First, an erosion and sediment control plan had to be developed. Second, the land disturbing activity must actually follow that plan. Next, buffer zones are required around all waters. Fourth, cut and fill slopes have to be geotechnically stable, as in they won't just collapse. And ground cover is required within 21 days. Note that this part of the act has been overridden by the federal non-national pollutant discharge elimination system permit, which requires ground cover within 7 to 14 days. Also note that farming and forestry activities are not included as part of this program. The Division of Energy, Mineral, and Land Resources is in charge of enforcing the SPCA, Sedimentation Pollution Control Act. This includes inspecting any land disturbing activities at any time. They can issue a notice of violation, or NOV, if the project is not following the plan or is otherwise not in compliance with the SPCA. They are also tasked with enforcing the NPDES stormwater rules. If a project does not comply with the plan or the rules, civil penalties of up to $5,000 per day per violation can be imposed. For example, if a silt fence is not functioning, plus a sediment basin is full of sediment, that would be two $5,000 fines per day that went by without correcting the issues. Criminal penalties can also be brought if the fines do not result in compliance. Ultimately, the state can force all work to stop until the problems are corrected. It was recognized early on that the DOT, the largest land disturbing entity in the state, had too many sites for the Demler staff to inspect regularly. The two departments have an agreement that allows instead DOT to create their own inspection system, which would operate independently. This is overseen by the Roadside Environmental Unit, Field Operations Section. Every year, as part of this agreement, the Department of Environmental Quality staff conduct several inspections on NCDOT projects to determine if this program can be continued. In fact, DEQ has delegated this internal inspection authority to more than 50 counties, cities, and towns. The Roadside Environmental Unit, Field Operations Section, monitors all DOT land disturbing activities. It works closely with lead engineers on erosion and sediment control stormwater issues. It also has the authority to issue a number of warnings and violations, which we'll cover next. Often the ultimate method to gain compliance is to force all work to stop on a project until the erosion and sediment control issues are fixed. An ICA stands for Immediate Corrective Action. This is the equivalent of a notice of violation that DEQ might issue. An ICA is issued when the project is out of compliance, and usually grading operations are halted until the problems are fixed. The corrections need to be done within 24 hours, and the DOT inspector comes back within 5 working days to check on it. The goal is to keep a project in compliance and avoid NOVs if other agencies inspect the project. If for some reason the problems have not been resolved within 5 days, ICA extensions may need to be issued. If the problems continue, a continuing ICA with a stop work order may be issued to get the attention of the people involved. Stopping all work is very expensive for the contractor, and usually compliance is quickly achieved. Occasionally, the permits that were obtained, perhaps for disturbance in a buffer or a wetland, are not going to cover the work that needs to be done. In this case, a permit consultation is needed, and this is issued so the lead engineer and agencies involved can resolve the matter, usually with new permits. Sometimes the erosion and sediment control plan and the project do not match up very well, and in this case, an erosion control plan audit request is issued to get the plan design corrected and resubmitted through the roadside environmental unit. Here's a quiz question. If you receive an ICA, how much time do you have to fix the problem? Well, immediately might be best. It's really 24 hours, as you recall. Another division within DEQ is the Division of Water Resources. They are focused on the water resources of the state. If your project is affecting them, you will have to obtain a 401 permit to do the work required. This also includes riparian buffers, which we'll discuss in a minute. They can visit your project at any time, normally only when a complaint about water quality is made to them, and issue notices of violation. There are a number of environmentally sensitive areas in North Carolina. If your project falls within one of these, extra precautions will be added to the erosion control plan. This will also be noted on that plan. A number of rivers and streams in North Carolina receive extra riparian buffer protection. You may notice Little Goose Creek down here just east of Charlotte is noted, and that's because it has a particularly healthy population of freshwater mussels, and so they get extra protection. Riparian buffer rules apply as 50-foot buffers around Randleman Lake, the Neuse, Tar, Pamlico, and Catawba River basins. Goose Creek, as I just mentioned, with its freshwater mussels, has an even wider buffer. Jordan and Fall Lakes, the water supply for much of the Triangle area, also have special rules. A riparian buffer is simply the area adjacent to a body of water. The rules typically divide the buffer into 2 zones, with zone 1 being more restrictive than zone 2. Here, the 50-foot buffer is divided into a 30-foot and a 20-foot section. Zone 1 is generally wooded, and zone 2 can be in managed vegetation, such as grass or pasture. Once a permit to disturb a buffer is in place, you can see the following 5 practices are allowed in zone 1. Silt fence, special sediment control fence, both types of check dams, and sediment bags. These all can be installed and removed with relatively little disturbance. Zone 2, all those allowed in zone 1 can be installed, plus slope drains and rock inlet protection type C, which is typically put around a storm drain. The Jordan Lake rules also require a 50-foot buffer, plus fertilizers such as those needed to establish grass can only be applied once. Around the Upper Neuse River watershed, sediment basins are larger based on a 25-year storm instead of a 10-year storm. The channels cannot have steep slopes. All sediment basins have to be skimmer basins, and the ground cover requirements are stricter than the SPCA, although we already discussed how the NPDES 7 to 14 day requirement would already cover this. There are 20 counties in North Carolina which have some part of them adjacent to coastal waters. In these counties, the Division of Coastal Management has jurisdiction over these waters. Like the Division of Water Resources, they can inspect an NCDOT project and issue those NOVs if compliance issues are found. The federal agency most involved in NCDOT projects is the Army Corps of Engineers. They have jurisdiction over all surface waters of the United States, and a permit from them is needed for any activities in those waters. They can inspect projects at any time and issue their version of an NOV, a cease and desist order, which stops all work until compliance is achieved. While we're talking about compliance issues, let's review something from the first module on the certification program. How many NOVs or notices of violation does it take to get your certification suspended? Yeah, it could be just one from any agency. Remember, that is not automatic, but is up to the NCDOT to determine. If a project will impact areas with threatened and endangered species, agencies such as the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission, and others will be involved in obtaining a permit to work in that area. This will also be noted on the Erosion Sediment Control Plan, something like endangered species are present or similar. Freshwater mussels are most often the concern in North Carolina as they are so rare. Historic properties are also protected from impacts, and the State Historic Preservation Office has to sign off that there are none that will be impacted. Occasionally, grading operations uncover historic artifacts, and the State Historic Preservation staff have to be allowed to recover them before work can continue. While we were covering regulatory requirements, a reminder that our erosion sediment control plans are part of compliance with the NPDES rules administered by DEMLR. NCDOT has a permit to discharge stormwater from roadways, construction sites, borrow pits, and industrial sites. It also has to comply with a construction general permit, or NCGO1, as we discussed. Also a reminder that under NCGO1, the DOT has to inspect discharge points and BMPs, install appropriate control measures at discharge points, monitor rainfall, and provide timely ground cover. To summarize, you should be aware of what regulations impact your project and review the permit conditions and drawings to become familiar with them. Identify the permitted areas on your plans and mark them clearly. Also, review the erosion sediment control plans to get familiar with the location of the stormwater discharge outfalls for all your inspections. And don't forget that you can and should ask questions if you need something clarified on the plans. This is the end of this module.